pastor at Midway Church here has agreed to do our invocation. So, Pastor Webb.
Sure. Father, thank you for such a beautiful day. We want to thank you for the wonderful country we live in. And we know that our country is made stronger and better because of municipalities like Bluefield and the interested citizens and the good leadership that you've blessed us with. We pray that you will bless the meeting tonight. May it be positive and productive. May you receive all of the glory. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Now, pledge allegiance.
We've got to get after where we're going with the city. It's very important we need to go after the city. It's very important that we also include the citizens on where, so that they're part of the process on this. As I started bouncing this idea off of individuals, there was a clear understanding. We were all in the same sheet of music that nobody knew what a comprehensive plan was. Everybody had sort of an idea. And so I thought, okay, before we start this process, I think it's very important that we bring everybody on the same sheet of music, so we start talking about it, we all have the same terms of reference, and we understand what the comprehensive plan is, because as we start discussing this, it'll keep us from going into the weeds, if you will. We have to stay up at the stratosphere, up the clouds here, if you will, and have a vision on where we're going to be going with the city. And then underneath a comprehensive plan are strategic plans that get after stovepipes, if you will, to make sure that those stovepipes are all integrated. And so I asked Josh to throw together a briefing. So we're going to do a little bit of death by PowerPoint. And please ask questions if you don't understand what we're talking about as we get through this. And hopefully, when you walk out of here tonight, you have a better understanding of this about 6 to 8 month process of where we're going to get after. Now, the good piece about this is that a lot of the data, and remember, there's data, there's information, and then that information that is in leaders' hands becomes knowledge, and that's how we make decisions. And so the data is resonant that's out there, and we're going to capture all of that, so that's the good piece, that's the hard part. Now it's a matter of taking that data and analyzing it so we can put it in leaders' hands so we can make decisions. Okay. So I'm going to turn over to Josh real quick.
It's a little warm.
Yeah.
Hot night. All right. Nice thing is I can hold it down here and still be heard. Can we turn this front row lights off just so everybody can see? And if I'm in the way, I'll try to move to the side. Bobby, can you go ahead and flip this over? Just a comprehensive plan is generally just a roadmap for the future. It's a 10-year plan. It gives you an idea of, or a municipality, a direction and an area in which we're moving for the next 10 years. Go ahead and hit that one more time. Okay. And it's, like we said, it's a guiding policy document, and it's a chance for the community to really determine what its future is for the next 10 years. You're going to hear a lot about community input, community engagement. We're going to talk a little bit more about some new ways to engage a little bit later in the presentation. But one of the main questions we need to ask ourselves and we need to answer during this process is for the next 10 years, in the next 10-year period, who are we and what do we aspire to be? That needs to be resonant on our minds as we're taking this process and we're thinking critically about what is going to be best for the community in the next 10 years. Okay, so why do we even do this? Why is this important? Well, first off, the state says you have to do it, so that kind of makes it important. Chapter 8A of the code requires the update and the development every 10 years of this plan. And it's a forcing mechanism. It encourages you to be engaged and be active in your community. It holds leaders accountable for new projects and ideas so things don't get stagnant, stale, and we sit back and we say, well, I wonder why nobody's done X, Y, or Z. So it's very important. It helps us identify opportunities for new development, new initiatives, ideas. It forces us to say, what if, and then begin to fill in those blanks. It also directs future investments to the right places by providing a land use document. That's one of the most most important and critical pieces of this document is it helps set in place air zoning laws for the city. So talking about land use will be a very important part of this document. Talking about where we want to see development happen, what we want to happen in certain parts of the city will be a part of this. It also prioritizes our infrastructure updates. You're going to hear a lot about that from our city manager and our board in the next few years about getting after infrastructure updates and what we need to do to really begin fixing some of our age systems, but also looking at new initiatives. For example, one of the ideas that we floated around is, heck, anytime the ground is open, why don't we put conduit down and make it so that we can put fiber in at a future point? Those are future what-ifs that we need to be considering, so thinking broadly about those things. Looking at more on the local scale instead of the grand scale of the state saying this is why you need to do it locally, it helps us be proactive rather than reactive. We sit and we start to think about the problems that are going to be facing us. We look into the crystal ball, if you will, I don't know if that's great to say in church or not, but you look into the crystal ball and you begin to really say, okay, what's going to happen in the next 10 years? What do we know that's coming up that we're going to have to deal with? And it puts it in a plan, and it, as Dan said, it keeps the local government on task. People come and go, situations change. This document is supposed to be that guiding force. It keeps the local government accountable no matter who's there. I think that's a very important part. For the past decade or so, it seems like Bluefield's taken a lot of left and right turns of new people, new directors, new city managers. This is a document that's supposed to keep your community in an ongoing track. And it's also important because it's a tool for you, the community, to be able to look at and hold your local government leaders accountable. You said, Mr. Mayor, Mr. and Mrs. Board Member, that you were going to do this. And so it's an accountability piece as well. It helps us in, so yeah, that's for you guys. It also maximizes efficiency in providing services. It helps us look at our processes. How do we provide services? What's coming up that we know we need to do with the fire department, with the police department, those types of things. Finally, and again, you're going to hear us say this a lot, it's a community-driven plan. Public input is going to be a very large part of this process. This is your plan as a city. Where do you want to go? What do you want to see? And then the leaders will take those ideas and form them into a generalized plan. So what goes into the plan? There's many required areas that we're going to have to report on and set some goals, objectives, and initiatives that we want to tackle. Again, going back to land use and talking about zoning, that's very important. Housing needs that are in our area, transportation infrastructure, going back to some of those critical needs that we have. Public services role, which is a little bit less for us as a developed city. Recreation needs, economic development, renewal and redevelopment, again, preferred areas of development. And financing, I really want to talk about that. This plan will also force us to think about how are we going to cover these things? How are we going to pay for them? What do the city's finances look like in the next 10 years? So those are very important. Your budget is not your financial plan. And I think we'll talk a little bit more about that as this process goes on. There are real needs that we have in the city, and asking the question, how are we going to pay for it, is going to be very important. And then also historic preservation. Will be areas that we'll create some initiatives around, and as we have hold our public meetings, we'll talk a little bit more about specific areas during those times. There are also six other areas that the state says you can focus on. If you'd like to also include that, we can include a little bit of history, which tends to be a trend in your introduction to your document. Everybody talks a little bit about where we've been and who we are as a city. When we look at other plans that other cities have put together, environmentalism, tourism, which I think is something that we really should look at with their proximity to things like the Hatfield McCoy Trail, conservation, safety, and natural resource use. So how does this process start? Well, we're actually already in it. The Planning Commission has met. They have recommended to the City Board of Directors that we start this this comprehensive plan process, and the board has directed the city manager's office to begin that. So we're in step one right now, and we're also beginning step two, and you heard Dane say a little bit earlier, looking at that data that's resonant in existing plans. We have a lot of plans in Bluefield, plans that we've had folks that have been foundations that have been generous enough to pay for and help the city with, but also events that we've been part of and citizens that have provided information as well that we need to look at and bring that information back in. Reviewing community statistics, looking at what our community looks like. It's a kind of a chance to look in the mirror to see who we are as a community. And then identifying those trends of where have we been, what's happened over the past 10 to 20 years. We also need to create a vision statement. Where do we want to be in the next 10 years? That's going to be very key. Again, goals, objectives, and key issues and concerns within those different areas that we talked about earlier are going to be very important. And we create an action plan around those. We say this is
how we're going to get after that. After we put this nice big document together, the Planning Commission is going to review it, make a recommendation to the Board of Directors to approve it. And once the Board of Directors approves it, it's in place. We'll make any ordinance changes that need to be made. We'll go through and we'll begin the process of adopting that plan. This is the big key. It needs an annual review. You just don't put it on the shelf and let it sit there. That's not acceptable. So we're going to take it, we're going to go through, and we're going to be able to take a look at where are we, how are we doing. We'll have some evaluation measures that we'll be able to put in place and check out and see, are we making progress? Where are we not making progress? But this will also help us as we develop annual budgets, looking to see what our priorities are going to be for the upcoming year. Where does our money need to go in relation to that and those types of things. And again, public feedback is critical to this process. We're going to utilize a tool called MindMixer in this process. Wheeling, Huntington, and Charleston have all used it, and it's been really impressed. It helps us utilize social media as we interact with the general public and ask for information. Just some stats that they provided, 58% of adults have a smartphone, 87% of American adults use the internet. So that's a pretty good percentage to say, hey, people can use this. And looking at folks that may not be part of a public meeting or a process is going to be important too. 78% of teens have a cell phone. Social media use is going to be very important. In the Pew Research Study and also the Corporation for National Community Service provided these stats. 9% of adults have attended one public meeting per year, and this is school board meetings, Pullman Nurse Associations, town hall meetings, PTA meetings, those types of things. That's very low, so we need to meet people where they're at, not always expect them to come to us. So if you take the population of Bluefield, all 10,447 of us according to the last census, and look at the percentage that's here tonight, obviously we're not reaching everyone, and so we need to meet people where they're at. Also, 48% of adults have never attended a public meeting. In America last year, over $1 billion were spent on holding public meetings. So, again, the importance of meeting people where they're at is really important. This is just a quick snapshot of what MindMixer looks like. We'll get to rename it what we'd like to. We're finalizing our contracts with them right now. Superior Colorado used theirs, and they called it Engage Superior. So as you can see, you come in, you can log in, you can actually check out what topics are being discussed. The city will actually pose questions to people and ask for their input. We were reviewing Huntington's today just to take a look and see what they were asking. Their latest question was, what kind of housing needs do you think there are in Bluefield? Do we need multifamily units? Do we need single-family units? Do we need residential space for students? Do we need retirement space, one-level living for seniors? And so it allows us, again, just to gather more feedback. And you're also able to see who else is joining the conversation. And one of the neat things is you'll also be able to see who is following and tracking that conversation from City Hall. But there's great ideas that get to be shared there, and it's another way just to hear people. And it's interactive. You can do it on your smartphone while you're in the grocery store, or you're getting your coffee in the morning, or just living your daily life. You don't have to come to a public meeting to share your great idea with city leaders, which is really nice. So after that, the plan will be in place, and I really like this quote. I got to attend West Virginia University College of Law. They had a land use clinic this year, and a lot of this information came from them, so I just wanted to give kudos to them real quick for the information. But their director shared this quote with us as we were leaving. He said, developing a comprehensive plan is the easy task. The challenge lies in implementing the vision, goals, and objectives into everyday operations. And that's going to be the important part. This is easy. It's putting ideas together. Making it work is what's going to be important. And that still continues to carry public feedback and input from you. So stay engaged in the process. Again, like the mayor said, we'd love to see you on Tuesdays at board meetings. Come and let us know what you're thinking. That's really important. And then also utilize these social media services. There's a few more that we'll be rolling out in the next year as well. We want to hear from you. We're very blessed to live in the democracy and in the country that we do. So I always encourage everyone, stay involved. But Dan, anything you'd like to add?
Great job.
Josh laid out with the nuts and bolts. Let me give you a couple things on why, the why behind all of this. Blue Field is a decisive point in its history right now. Okay, we've and I'm the new guy here, so I don't come from a good old boy network. You know, I'm not part of, you know, one team or the other. I'm coming in with an objective lens on Blue Field. And I'll tell you, be honest, completely honest with you, I hear a lot about, well, Cole's going to come back, okay, and Cole's going to do this because of Cole and all that type of stuff. I have to tell you, we have to have a plan that we can wrap our arms around and we can move this city forward, okay, and it has to have an economic driver. And it's not going to be because we lost Wendy's or because we lost, you know, Sears. There needs to be a no-kidding reason why Bluefield is relevant. Okay, and we've got to come up with that, and that's what this conference is going to get after. I'll tell you, there's some pretty audacious ideas out there, and that's what we have to do, is we have to be progressive. And so what we're going to be doing is we're going to be, with this comprehensive plan, we're going to set the environment. We're going to quit messing around with that was the old board's plans, the new board's plans. We have to all row together in the same direction, because both sides of the fence have great ideas. But it has to be to move Bluefield forward. Now, let me kill a couple of rumors out there. So Princeton's not getting everything, okay? So don't think that by any means. Exit 9, all right, is in the county, okay? So quit worrying about Princeton, let's worry about Bluefield, okay? The development of Bluefield, all right? And we'll move this place forward. So let's focus internally. Now, the hardest thing to do with an organization is to look and see themselves. And so we've got to set some metrics out there. Right? You've probably heard my mantra. I've told the city staff that they're not allowed to do things because that's the way we've always done it, because it's not working. Okay? And so now with a comprehensive plan, and this is going to get after very detailed, strategic stuff. And so on the board, I love them to death, and we will come in with a plan, and every once in a while, the board members will see a squirrel. Squirrel! And we'll go off this direction. You know? Shiny object. And don't get me wrong, great ideas, they're all great ideas, but we have to take a step back and ask a question. Does this fit into our comprehensive plan? And if it doesn't, we don't need to put energy behind it, money against it, or definitely resources of any kind in the city, because we're very limited and we've got to keep pushing that forward. And this plan has to survive the board. Because, as Josh said, left and right turns.
That's not saying much about our re-election.
when you bring in new individuals, they have to stay on track. Because we've got to get after it. Now, change is hard for everybody, okay? But you have to trust that we need your feedback. That's where this mind mixer is powerful. I don't think that this is another topics. Is that what you all care? It's not. You actually have to log in as yourself. You have to have a profile, and we have to know who you are, and not somebody like we saw in a paper that was in a different state under an alias that was commenting on stuff that was untrue. So we need that feedback. We need to be part of the process. So we say we're gonna have a committee together. We're gonna meet. We're gonna talk about infrastructure, for example. I will tell you, we have to have a better plan than we have now. Your stormwater is destroyed, it's falling apart. Your roads are being paved once every 109 years. We probably ought to have a plan on how we're going to bring that back to industry standards. You see where I'm going with this? And so we'll talk about this piece. And there's got to be some give and take on it. So pretty powerful stuff. You're going to see that I'm automating as much as I possibly can. Mind Mixer is one. You're going to see another thing come out of the public stuff, which is pretty powerful, which will fit in with this. And then we're going to also have a mass notification system. So you got to be part of the solution. It's easy to sit back and be a naysayer, but you got to be part of the solution on why we're getting after things. And I think you're going to find out we're going to do certain things, and you're going to sort of scratch your head and go, I don't understand why we're doing that. And then about 6 months later, you're going to go, I got it. You know, build ready sites for businesses to come in that have infrastructure, high-speed internet, and utilities, and it makes them easy to develop. We've got to make Bluefield relevant. And I got to tell you, If we don't do it right this time, you know, we're watching a decline. We're actually watching, I don't know if we'll be able to recover. So that's why this one's pretty important to us. Okay, so I'm going to stop right there. Hopefully you get an idea of where we're going with this, and then we'll open it up for some questions unless the board members have a point.
All right. Thank you, Dave. Just sitting up here, I'm excited. I don't know, but to me, you know, I'm kind of saying, is this really Bluefield? I really am feeling energized and excited about where we can go. And there's a book, Good to Great. Jim Anderson, what's his name? Jim Collins. And he talks about getting people on the bus. Well, if we talk about the city as the bus, I think we got somebody behind the wheel that we can really get behind. You know, I've talked to the department heads in the city, and we've said, well, each department head has a responsibility, and that's sort of just matter of fact. You know, the police department arrests bad guys, and the fire department puts out fires, and you know, each department does their own thing. But what I'm so excited about, what Dane's bringing to our city, is we're getting all of it going in the same direction. We want to go in the same direction. So that's an exciting process that we're undertaking, and we definitely want to hear from you. So let me just kind of go over the rest of the agenda for tonight. We're going to open it up for public comments, and any of us will be available to answer your question or address your comments. We do have an action item that we'll do at the end of the meeting. So that's I think that's the first time we've taken action outside of the you know, an actual city board action. So anyway, it's a historic event maybe. But anyway, we'll do that, and then we'll close the meeting. So anyway, this is our town hall meeting. We want to hear from you. So Josh has a microphone. If anybody would like to speak, just raise your hand. Mr. Feathers?
I might as well speak first. I'm sure everybody can hear me. But anyway, I really appreciate the city manager, and his first thought when he comes to town is they're doing one street, the same street, over and over and over again, which is true. When I asked about my street, you know, they get the street on the right of me, they get the street on the left of me. I go down and I ask Tony, I said, Tony, when is my street going to be paved? Never. That took care of that, so that's just about what I've been getting from City Hall for the last 33 years. I think, with this program, if it's true, and if it goes through, and if the city will do what they say they want to do, maybe it might work. On my street.
What street is that?
I live at 119 Jaw Street. I'm Earl Fabry, if any of you don't know. I'm at 119 Jaw Street. Stormwater. So I called the sanitary board about a drain not working up above. So they come up there, they check it out, say, it's caved in just like you said. So they come up there, 4 or 5 bags of concrete, and they feel it good. Alright, down the other end of my street. I got another drain down there that caved in. So I called the sanitary board about that. My daughter wrecked on that. 1 year at Christmas because ice was forming and the storm drain wasn't catching it. Ice was forming all over the street, so a car came down and just slid right into it. So I asked the sanitary board to come up and check it out. Said, John, you're right, they put the street sign right down through it. So, well, we can't do anything about that because that belongs to the state. I said, well, how about somebody calling the state? Nobody's ever called, I don't think, from the school. Really, I don't think anybody cares because I live on the east end. Monthly, the four sections of Bluefield, really 5 million if you want to count. The only thing that matters is South Bluefield. What about West Bluefield? What about North Bluefield? What about East Bluefield? Where I'm at. All right. So that's so much for storm water. So I called the sanitary board out there and I said, well, what about my storm water that's coming off my houses? Are they going in the old one? I said, no. We'll come up and check it. I ain't seen nobody yet. But they can't check it because they have to go all the way down to Bluefield Avenue to run line all the way up to the old one. They put a new one from my house, the one down here. I've already had three cavemen. That girl's still about that. All right, that's so much for the stormwater, but they're coming. All right, now, the recycling. Every year, the city has free pickup. One year, they said it cost $30,000 to $40,000.
You're speaking of the spring cleanup, not the recycling program. Those are two different things.
Right, this is what I'm saying. It's coming up. Right? Next year.
Right.
Okay. So, why not have it way before that, have a recycling program? Have everybody to clean up, get all recycled. The city makes a little bit of money. I don't know how to do it. No, my business, I recycle. I'm the only person on my street recycling, but I recycle. Okay. Now, city employees. I think the city travels every street, everywhere in Bluefield, every solitary day. Why can't they bring up some of the problems they see that everyday citizens see, but they won't call City Hall? I don't call City Hall. Why? I can't hear. I got injured in the arm. I have my ears followed out. I wear hearing aids. I hear 70%. Maybe. But then a lot of times I'll say, what'd you say? And he understands that problem. That's a problem. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Feathers. I guess one of the things that I would say, you know, you bring up some relevant issues, but those are certainly things that Dane has talked about. And, you know, it was something I didn't think about particularly when we were doing our paving projects and how much are we paving and how many miles of road are there actually in Bluefield. And so that is something that Dane's on. He's talking about the infrastructure, the stormwater.
I meant to say one more thing. I had the city come up there and check my street. It's ran wrong. It's not dragging right. That's the reason I got all of my flood water. That's the reason I had the cave in up there. And the street and the city's never come up and fixed the street. It's still shut.
Well, sir, the Department of Highways never fixed the wrong grade on the I-77 either, so.
Okay, who's next?
Let me give you a little feedback on this. Great questions, by the way. Great questions. Okay, so real quick on storm drains. 2,000 of these catch basins out all over the place, and they're failing, about 60 to 80 years old. And the guys are getting after pretty heavy. Matter of fact, we're going to start seeing them on Saturdays working. We've authorized overtime because we just can't get in front of them fast enough. So the city doesn't own a camera. So we can't figure out the condition of the storm drains or the storm, they're clay pipes, terracotta pipes. So we have guys, city employees, actually crawling through the pipes to check the condition and taking pictures of it. So we're going to work to get them a camera. But we're getting after it. As a matter of fact, we had an intern, and that was one of our big initiatives, is we're starting out with interns. It'll be working with us from Bluefield State, Bluefield College, and Concord, helping us get after these storm drain diseases. So that's slowly but surely, we'll start getting after this infrastructure. You're absolutely right with the state roads. So there's 27 miles of state roads, and don't quote me on that. I'm pretty sure it's 27 miles of state roads inside the city of Bluefield. And we are working, and I agree with you, the District 10 is not as responsive as we would like them to be. So we are trying to put some pressure on it. Bland Street is a perfect example. That's 52 state road. I can't even send my guys out to patch the holes on it. So we're working through that piece. Now, the city employees, right? Here's, and you're right, they're all over the place. And I've got something better for you than that. We're gonna roll this thing out here pretty quickly. But it's an app called Public Stuff, and I've been talking at a lot of churches, so I'm now concerned. So this Public Stuff app is going to allow the citizen, and we'll use potholes as an example, to take a picture of the pothole. It integrates with the GPS in the phone, so I know the location of it. It sends it back to the city, and because you've routed it to Public Works, it'll go to the Public Works Director, and a work order will be assigned to it. And now he can take a look at all of the potholes, and he can prioritize his route and his work efforts. And when we fill that pothole, and he closes out that work order, it's going to send you an email back saying, we completed your action. That's how we're going to get after this. Okay? It's the same thing for barking dogs and too high of grass and litter that you see along the way. We'll be able to, you'll be able to, the public will be able to log on and tell us with a picture and show us where those problems are.
We're going to have that sent to your personal cell phone, man. Those are going to come straight to you.
20 years.
We've got a lot of people here. We need to get around. I'm sure there's other questions. Please say your name before you speak so we can get that for our minutes, Norris.
Norris Taylor. And it's more of a comment than with a question. Because for years, there's an asset in this city that, for whatever reason, until just recently, the city has refused time after time after time to use that asset. And the value of that, using it, most of that is all for free. Highly trained professionals. And I'm referring to Bluefield State College. So I'm hoping that you're going to truly use those assets over there. Because I can tell you, they have been offered time and time again, free of cost. And they're usually what they come up with is something that is doable and usable. And it's interesting because the problem is the camera going on the ground. I suspect that if you talk to the engineering department over at Bluefield State, they have the means already to do things like that. It doesn't cost to do it. So that's it.
Thank you, Norris. And we do plan on, we've really worked hard on our partnership with Bluefield State College. I think you recognize that, but we've worked very hard. Josh has been very instrumental in that, and we sincerely value Bluefield State College's involvement. So who else has a comment? Or imagine that.
My only comment is this.
Give your name.
Art Riley. Sorry. My comment is this. In conjunction with the comprehensive plan, on October the 6th, we're going to find out whether we get home rule or not. Now, that will affect a lot of the things that go into the comprehensive plan. Is it the city's intention to work very closely with that on the changes in the ordinances that have been suggested? Work to amend the comprehensive plan.
Absolutely.
We're
very much counting on home rule. I mean, I'll be shocked, but I don't want to count a chicken before it's hatched. But I feel very positive about that. Josh did a fantastic job with our presentation. invitation to the Home Rule Board, and I feel very positive and very hopeful about that. I think that it'll be extremely beneficial to helping move the city forward. So thank you for your comment, Art. There was
I'm Teresa Braithwaite, and my comments are all living around communication. I was able to meet with you and with the new city manager earlier in the week, and we discussed this very issue in regards to communication. Number one, the biggest issue that myself and my husband are made aware of, basically on a daily occurrence, is the fact that the public really does not know what is taking place with the government, city government. Not everybody gets the newspaper any longer. The majority of the people that call our home asking what's going on are not computer literate, and therefore, we are not getting the word out to our citizens. It's not that the citizens do not want to be engaged. It's the fact that basically either based upon the ability to pay for a newspaper or they're of an age where they don't want to embrace today's technology, they don't have that option to see what's going on. My concerns in regards to the communication issue with the mind mixer, I've already touched on it. I have a lot of individuals that are seniors that do not embrace the technology. Therefore, they're not going to be the ones to utilize the mind mixer. Our young people are so totally disengaged, and unless we bring them on board, and they are that asset that we need for our future, so I ask that maybe we look for some sort of program where we go to the schools. And I grew up here in Bluefield, and in seventh grade, I was a civics student. Our children are not being taught civics. They have no clue what goes on once they progress to where they might even consider what it is to be part of today's society. So maybe we should look forward, and this is part of the thinking broadly, maybe we should look towards sending somebody that can engage these children so that they understand what it is to be part of the future, because they are the future. There was another topic that was discussed when I met with you gentlemen, was the fact that we have a 10% versus a 90%. We have such a polarized community. We have 10% of the population that makes decisions in a void, and they don't look at the 90% in regards to what the 90% are looking for in regards to what they want within their community. Unless we can open up a better lines of communication, provide for the totality of the community, we're merely spinning our wheels. Putting lipstick on a pig still is a pig at the end of the day. So I'm asking that we reach out and find a way. I will volunteer my time. We need to embrace the entire community. That's my biggest desire for this community.
May I ask if you have any suggestions as to how we could possibly communicate better with those people who do not embrace new technology, who cannot afford the newspaper? We have work sessions in the mornings before our board meetings, which are open to the public. They're posted. The agenda is posted. Maybe if we, you know, should we stand on top of the West Virginia Manor and
get
megaphones or a bullhorn? If you have a suggestion, we would be more than loved to. We thought as a board that taking the suggestion to have meetings out in the community where we did board work would help somewhat. But if you had a suggestion, please let us know.
Well, I think the fact that, you know, this particular venue within a church, talk to your ministers. You have a ministerial association within your city that is a very strong organization. Talk to them about hosting within their own churches a venue where they can bring in. The technology exists. Case of West Virginia has the technology that you can come within and connect to a laptop and show those people that are hesitant to embracing technology just how simple the technology is. I mean, you've made the right steps, but like I say, we're missing a whole generation of young people, and I'm going to tell you.
Well, I think that MindBender is at MindMixer is absolutely going to. You said we have a disengaged youth, and I would disagree with you. I think they're engaged. I just don't think that they're engaged in a traditional manner. They're engaged through social media and things that have just come around in recent years. And that, you know, Josh is the double thumber, right? Double thumber. And he brings a lot to the table from that standpoint. And this board's worked very hard, and certainly, you know, our city staff is embracing that. And we're gonna work to make ourselves as transparent, provide as much information, try and get the word out through however many different sources there are. And certainly, as Alan said, if you have specific suggestions, let us know. I mean, there's some people you just, unless you go door to door, and you know, they probably don't want that particularly either. But you know, it's difficult. You know, there are people that don't want to be reached, in a sense. So it's difficult. Anyway, go ahead, Lefty, and then we'll move over here.
Pete Sternoff, I want to comment a little bit in the direction of the start by Mrs. Brakelig, and also talk about something that her husband is very involved in, which this gentleman sitting to the left of me has been very involved in, and I think this is a good way to be able to start working with communications. The framework already exists within the city in some of the neighborhoods in what we call neighborhood associations. We actually have still a very aggressive and very participative Downtown Neighborhood Association with a lot of great people in it. The South Bluefield, which actually encompassed more people on one side of Bland Road than on the other, was very involved for many years. And I don't think it would be that hard to get that going again, because at one time there was a north side. And you want to talk about a way to communicate with people, because a city member of the city administration can go to these meetings and we can get these groups going again and actually talk to them about what's going on. Both those associations being active, a huge amount of people would come to them. And they give feedback to city people, and then the city comes back and answers their questions. So that, to me, is one great way of being able to solve part of the problem that Mrs. Bravery brought up, is getting the neighborhood associations going again. They were great. A lot of good ideas came out of them, so let's hope to do. And I love what we're doing with technology. Keep it up, man. It's just great.
Thank you, Pete.
I don't have I have a comment.
How about your name?
My name is Juanita Gray. I've been around here for a long, long time. My concern is, and I know you all mentioned it at the board meeting last week, we watched it on TV, about the ISO rating. For Bluefield, West Virginia, which I believe is class 4, and the fire chief was working on what was necessary. I hope nothing happens that we do not lose our class 4 rating. If it should go up, then we're going to pay more for our insurance premiums. So maybe someone has an answer to that. I know there's a lot of criteria involved with the insurance services office. But anyway, that is my concern, the ISO rating for Bluefield, West Virginia.
I did not plant her. I just want you to know that I love her.
Yes, you did.
It's a great question, and ISO so. You explained it better than I could. And yes, the fire department's going after it. They've got a laundry list of things they can come back to us with. There's some constructive credits that we can get after. So when that inspection does happen, we don't lose our rate. Now, I will tell you that I've already talked with several insurance agencies, and the good thing is they batch the ISO ratings. And so the guys helping back here, if I screw this up, 2 through 4 is 1, the next one is 5 and 6, and so the jump isn't as bad or as dramatic as we thought it would be. The big piece is one, we're prepared for it. The fire department is all over it. Two, we're already engaging in communications with that to make sure that we have put in place processes so we get constructive credit for certain things. I use an example of a training center. We don't have our own training facility. However, we use Princeton's. And so if that's not articulated in their inspection, then we don't get credit for it. It's just because it doesn't reside in Bluefield doesn't mean we don't get credit for it. So it's very important. I will tell you that the fire chief is doing great leaps and bounds. Now, there's a couple of things that I've got to bring back to the board and say, okay, we've got to either hire more firefighters or buy a certain piece of equipment or, you know, a training officer, for example, is one of the ones that's very important out there that we haven't got after to make sure that we maintain that ISO 4 rating. But anyway, I'm voting for you if you're running for it.
Everybody else should vote too if they don't get it. Hopefully it will remain that way because our rates will go up and we'll all be paying everybody, and with the West Virginia we'll be paying more for your fire insurance.
That's right. And real quick, a raise of hands, how many people watch this on TV? Just so we're just trying to get an idea. Okay, so that's a good thing. I mean, everybody has a chance to look at that.
Okay. How do I look? Do I look okay off the camera? Does my hair look okay?
So we probably need to put this on the website.
If you could stream it in, sure.
Because if you don't have Comcast, you can't get the local access station.
So even if we uploaded it the next day and you were able to watch it, like a YouTube video that's on our website, that would be something that everybody...
That'd be great.
Okay.
Jerry Ball Snyder. I don't really have a question, but I just want to comment. And this is the second time I was able to hear Danny Rideout speak. And I'm very, very impressed. I'm very grateful that we have him here with our city board, and as well as knowing about these town meetings, I think is an excellent idea. You talk about communication. This is Bluefield, and all everybody does in this town is talk. So it gets around. And the more people that find out about these meetings, and the more people talk to other people, you'll be able to get more and more crowd. And I think you've done an excellent job, and I appreciate the time that you've taken out, you know, to give it to the community.
Thank you. Who else had it?
Hey, did you have Randy Harvest, I live in Midway, and I have been almost 4 years trying to get a boat put in the culvert out there. It's been out almost 4 years, and I have been to the city board, I've called the state, the railroad, and Glenn Taper has too. And we still don't have a bulb in there yet. We've got one, but the other one is out and they won't be able to put it in. And it's dark when you go through there and you cannot see. And it's really dangerous to go through there at night. Dan can tell you that himself. Anybody that lives in Midway or goes that way can tell you. Thank you.
I see Dane up here making some notes. We'll certainly.
My guess is you'll have one tomorrow.
Well, let's try and.
Or pretty soon. Because I won't be done.
We'll make sure that whoever the responsible person is for that will touch base with them. I don't know if that's a city, a railroad. I'm not sure.
The railroad says it's a city.
Well, that's perfect. That's the way it's supposed to work. That way we can keep people at bay. We'll figure it out. We'll get to the bottom of it and make something happen there. That's pretty simple. Marty?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Marty Gearhart. I would just like to congratulate this board and city manager on the fact that they're taking on the planning process. This seems to be long overdue, and I don't think that we can be successful without having a plan in place. I would also encourage you to, they should set the plan to set some concrete and attainable goals, not to avoid good ideas that might seem like the squirrel, to take an end of the plan and not to be afraid of ditching those that don't appear to work. So, congratulations, kudos to you all, and I hope the plan comes out and we accomplish everything that's set forth inside.
And any influence you have with the Home Rule Board would be appreciated.
I have no influence, but on a final note, you do have three delegates. You have two state senators that represent the Bluefield in the state government. And you need to take advantage of them and lean on them and press us.
I don't know about that one senator guy.
Well, I don't know about one of the delegates either. And those things may change, regardless.
Look here, speak of the devil and the devil walks in.
Regardless of who those members are, we do have the interest of the city of Bluefield. We want us to be competitive with the folks across the state line. We work hard to do that, and you all need to make your concerns known to us. In the same manner that you want concerns known, not only what the problem is, but also a potential solution.
Ron?
I'm Ron Satterfield. I'd personally like, does everyone hear me? I'd rather not speak.
It's good.
Oh, okay. Really good. I'd like to respond to the lady concerning the publicity or the lack thereof. Just an example, I've been on the sanitary board, I believe, 8 or 9 years. How long have I been on, Art? Long time. And I know it's not an exciting thing to read about. It certainly doesn't match up with the sex crimes that cover our front pages. But in the 8 years that I've been there, I can remember one time that we've had a reporter at our meeting to be able to tell you what is or isn't going on. So some of the apathy that we see in the city, I think the mayor needs to have a heart-to-heart talk with the people that are running the editorial part of the paper, and he may not have any luck with it, but I think it's an integral part of it. Second thing that I'd like to speak to has to do with the economic opportunity that hopefully the Planning Commission will address and look at and not overlook what I believe is a wonderful opportunity to really develop a comprehensive retirement community. I think we have a lot of the strength. I don't think we have many of the weaknesses, and health care is the first one. And let me tell you, we've had a tremendous turnaround in the last 4 years in the health care in this city and the money invested in health care. And if you just look at everything that retirees desire, I think we have most of it. And I think it's a wonderful economic opportunity for our city to grow and to create jobs. I mean, these people, retirees bring money. They buy houses, they build houses, they shop, they attend churches, they contribute. It's just a wonderful part of anyone's economy that focuses on. And I think it's an opportunity that I hope the Planning Commission would not overlook.
All we need is an ocean, and we got it all.
Well, get there quick.
I do want to just make a comment about the hospital. They have done some phenomenal things. I mean, huge capital investment in their facility, and I think that's one of the problems with Southern West Virginia is not enough people reinvest in their business. And, you know, in my business, I spend a lot of money reinvesting. And even if I wanted to cut and run, I can't. I mean, even if I said, okay, I've had enough, I'm going to Florida to retire, I can't. I've got too much invested. So I think the more, and one of the things that I would challenge our legislatures here that are with us is a way to incentivize business to reinvest. It's already here. If the bakery had been reinvesting in their bakery, I think they would have been less likely to have shut down. But the hospital is a great example of a business that's in our city that's reinvesting. That's millions of dollars over the past several years. So anyway, thank you, Ron. Anybody else?
You thought it was about reinvest in our community. I came up here years ago, and I just bought two more houses on my street. I got 10 houses. Well, me and my family got 10 houses of mine for my kids and my grandkids. The lower part of Dow Street, you can't find a place to crash out of place. We keep our end straight, cleaned up.
Well, I know where you're going with this, and let me talk to that. When we took over a little over a year ago, when we took office, one of the first things we talked about as a board was wanting another code enforcement person. Lori Mills has done a phenomenal job. She really has. I mean, you know, you can find fault in anybody, but she has been an outstanding employee for the city. A lot of respect that we have for her, but she's only one person. So we wanted to hire another code enforcement person, and we did. He wasn't here that long. He got called back to another job. I don't recall exactly what there was, but Kevin Fleming is our second code enforcement officer. And Dane, we hire Dane, he comes on board. The first thing he says is, we need another code enforcement officer. So I think we're in the process, maybe close to hiring somebody or have. And in addition to that, we're also brought code enforcement under the police department. Our previous interim city manager, Dennis Dillon, who's our chief of police, did a phenomenal job in that role and really has a good finger on the pulse of the city. And we brought the code enforcement underneath the police department, deputized some other people. I mean, we've got a lot of people out there. As we move forward, that are going to be able to ensure that things that we want to see in our community, we see, and things that we don't want to see in our community, we don't see. And also talking about technology is really equipping the code enforcement people with the ability to quickly take action and certainly home rule. If we're approved for that, will give us additional abilities to get after some of those problems. So thank you. We do have an action item we need to get to, unless there's anything else that somebody.
I'd like to make a comment. You know, originally this town hall meeting was scheduled to talk a little bit about what we do and how city government works, which is one thing Mrs. Braithwaite, I totally agree with you that our children are not being taught a lot of things that we were being taught in high school. And one of them was about city government. I know when we had students at City Government Day, they all looked kind of lost as to what everybody did. And I'll tell you, one thing that surprised me is the number of people who said to me, Tommy Cole's the name, he doesn't get to vote, does he? Unless there's a tie. No, that's not true. We all get, there's five of us. Barbara Smith's not here tonight. She's out of town. We all get one vote. Tommy gets to vote just like the rest of us, you know? It's all one vote. Tommy was gracious enough to say he'd be the mayor, because the mayor's our spokesman, and he's got a lot of extra duties, but he gets the same vote the rest of us get. And this is a common misconception that he doesn't get to vote unless there's a tie. I think that should be straightened out. Another thing that I don't think you all realize is that Chief Billow here took some steps, and now you have twice as many police at one time out guarding your city as you once had. And that's a big thing. Things are looking up. The other thing that kind of irritated me when we first hired Colonel Rideout was people said, well, why do you want to come to Blue?
That's a pretty legitimate.
And he might shoot me, but I'm gonna, and then he told me he'd have to kill me if he told me some things, but anyway. He went back to West Point after that first visit and got maps of Litfield, and people were telling him, hey, this place is a gold mine. And you talked about a retirement place, and we've talked about lots of other things. We have a plethora of opportunities awaiting us. It's just we've all gotten so down in the mouth, you know. So we need somebody to come in here and get clear and say, hey, snap to it, let's get together and let's pull. Because we do have lots of opportunity. And I'm glad we found it. I really am. And I'm glad that I'm on a board that's 100% behind me. And I'm glad Tommy agreed to be mayor, so none of the rest of us have to go to all the stuff he has to go to.
Well, thank you, Ellen, and it's an honor. I mean, it really is an honor for me to be mayor of the city, and I appreciate the support that I got from my other board members. Please get involved, and as Ellen said, the initial plan for this meeting was to talk about city government and how it works, and Dane asked us to modify that so we could talk about this comprehensive plan, because that is really important, absolutely. Just hang on 1 second, I just want to finish this one, Paul. Please do get involved. We have a work session on the second and fourth Tuesday of every week. Did I say that right?
Month.
Of every month. Okay. Sorry. I knew it didn't sound right. I knew something was wrong. Then we have a board meeting at noon on the second Tuesday, and we have a board meeting at 6 o'clock on the fourth Tuesday. So please come out, get involved. Anyway, Chuck.
My name is Chuck McGonigal, and I can't pass up this opportunity to try to talk more than Ellen does.
Counting somebody.
I do have a comment and a question. One thing was the reason that you had mentioned the downtown merchants and the South Georgia merchants. And you made a comment there that if we continue those programs, a lot of people show up. Teresa's asking for more communications from the city, and I think that's obviously going to happen. However, I was involved with South Bluefield Merchants for probably 10 years. Jerry Ball can confirm numbers for me if she'd like. We had at one time 65 businesses in South Bluefield, and I'm going to estimate maybe half of them paid dues. There were five people that always showed up to meetings and always helped with lemonade days. So what I'm asking you is if we do what you want for communications and come up with all kinds of ideas and programs, how can we get people to come out? And along with that, I have to ask, we have a board meetings at noon, and I think the board feels like that a lot of people don't come because it's lunch hour. So we have them at 6. We've never had this kind of attendance. What brought you out tonight?
This is a town hall meeting. I think the use of the word town hall, where people were invited ahead of time to give input and to participate, had a lot to do with the fact that we've got such a great crowd tonight. And even though the paper didn't put the time in there, you can't imagine how many people called folks today saying, do you know what time the meeting is, because they wanted to be here. The other thing I would comment on is I know the South Bluefield Merchants Association was a very viable organization for a long time, as is the Downtown Merchants Association right now. But what we were discussing was the South Bluefield Neighborhood Association, which, again, is another idea. I just think it's great that we just look for every possible way we can for everybody to communicate. When our old board took over, one of the things Mike Insegara suggested, because he was a new member of the board, and of course now he's on the county commission, was setting up a phone system where, similar to a robocall system, where you program in phone numbers. So most of the robocall systems all let you use cell phones, unfortunately, but there could be ways to get phone registered where those calls can be made to let people know what's going on. A lot of good ideas can come out of all this. But I love the neighborhood association that Blaine Braithwaite had, and of course the downtown neighborhood association is one of the greatest meetings I go to every month.
Okay, well thank you all for your comments. Thank you for coming out. We have one little piece of business that we're gonna share with you all tonight. As you may have seen, or if you read the article, we have been on a search for a city treasurer, and advertised that position. We received a couple of really qualified applicants that were interviewed, and we had a one was just obviously the best candidate. I'll turn it over to Ellen here for just a moment to make a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I would like to move that we hire Kelly Davis to be our next city treasurer.
Okay, we have a motion before the board. Is there any further discussion?
Probably better say.
Should we let the people know what our qualifications are?
No, I think it's.
Here she is. She's having a qualified.
She had very qualified, has 10 years experience, 14 years experience with municipal accounting, and we're very excited about her application. So we have a motion. Any further discussion?
Second.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The ayes have it. And the hiring of Kelly Davis as the city's new treasurer is approved. Do any of you all want to make any comments?
I think I made my
point. Mike, do you have anything you want to say?
Only this. I look around and I don't know that I've seen as many people here gathered expressing interest in their community, in their city. And Ms. Braithwaite, you expressed concern that the word's not getting out. But I would ask you to look around. This is just the first one, I think, that's had this many people. It looks like the word is getting out, and your suggestions are well taken. But thank you all for coming. It's a real healthy thing to see people in your community working with us together to improve things. Thank you.
Nothing worse than throwing a party and nobody coming, so we appreciate you all. Coming out tonight. Motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned. Thank you all so much.